All right, let's turn to the book of Hebrews in our last class relating to the eternal plan. Bless you. We were talking about the preeminence of the Son, and we had actually started reading some of these scriptures here, but we didn't get finished. So we're going to look at Hebrews 1 again and read through verse 9. God, who at sundry times and in diverse manners spoke in time past unto the fathers by the prophets, hath in these last days spoken unto us. And again, the margin says, in Son, whom he hath appointed heir of all things, by whom also he made the worlds, who, being the brightness of his glory, the Son, being the brightness of his glory and the express image of his person, and upholding all things by the word of his power, when he had by himself purged our sins, sat down on the right hand of God, a right hand of the majesty on high. And if you compare this with that was cute, wasn't it? If you compare this last part here, when he had purged our sins, sat down on the right hand of the majesty on high, when you compare that with Ephesians 2, that said that he hath made us sit together in heavenly places, that we were raised up and made to sit together in heavenly places in Christ Jesus. And you understand that verse in Ephesians 2 is speaking of the same event right here. And so the thing that you have to comprehend then in this verse is that the purging of our sins was a finished work, was a something Jesus did in relationship to sin. Okay. And I personally use the term finished work, particularly in relationship to redemption, to sin, because it was that Jesus' death on the cross was once and for all. And he's not going to have to die again for anything that we've done wrong. He's already died for all sins, and that's finished. All right. But in this verse, there is an added thing that Ephesians brings into it. When he had by himself purged our sins, sat down on the right hand of the majesty on high. That's us being seated together with Christ in heavenly places. That's us in him. Well, where do we get that from? Well, of course, from Ephesians and a bunch of different places in the scriptures. But we also get it from verse 2 that says, in Son. Okay, that all of this now has happened in Son. All right, and the significance of that is, and you'll remember that we were discussing the eternal plan of God in two relationships, one of them that I share a lot on, and that's in relationship to Jesus and him getting Jesus getting a wife, getting a bride. And in this sense, the Jesus that it's talking about is the Lamb. Okay, that's significant. And it's the bride. Have you seen the bride, the wife of the Lamb? Okay, and this is part of the eternal plan of God. But the part that we've chosen to study in this class relates to the Father. And we can say that before the foundation of the world, in the determinate counsel of God, Jesus wanted a counterpart. Jesus wanted one after his kind. Jesus wanted that to be I don't know how to oneness brings intimacy, and intimacy is expressed in the term wife. So he wanted a counterpart, but it wasn't, it was one that would be with him almost on the same level, but it is the same level because of oneness, because the one is him. Okay, but the Father wants sons. And he wants sons in the image of Christ. And so this is part of what we're going to try to look at as we move forward here. But so in the Father's heart, there is, and this is something that you need to search out, there's just as many scriptures about the Father's heart wanting sons. There are just as many scriptures. And in fact, I will probably, who knows when, but I will probably send you on a search and ask you to come back with something like 5 scriptures that show this in different places in the New Testament. And it's so prevalent, but we never see it because in Christianity, our focus tends to be Jesus. Amen? And remember, we were talking about the Father in relationship to all of this, and that in the New Testament, almost all of the scriptures are prayed to the Father because of the Son within us. Because of the Son within us. And it is, you know, you remember, we truly our fellowship is with the Father, and his fellowship is with the Father, and that fellowship is with the Father and with his Son, Jesus Christ. And so there's this this reality that is not talked about much, that is not really examined, but it is this relationship that the Father wants sons, and I always add, he wants sons in the image of Christ, or in the image of the Son. Now, you're familiar with Romans 8, 28 and 29, that we might be conformed to the image of Son, his Son, Son. And his method for doing that also is oneness, oneness with the Son. That's a completely different relationship, though. We're talking about relationship. You relate completely different with Jesus in that relationship than you do in this relationship where we would become bride or wife. In that relationship, you relate to him as he is to the Father. And as he is to the Father, he is Son. And without Jesus in that relationship, then you have no Father. Why? Because it takes a son to be a father, or, you know, you can't just be a father. So this is declaring two things, and the two things that it's giving us is, number one, it's giving us, and I'm going to label it like this. This isn't the best way to do it, but I'm going to label it the plan of salvation, okay, who by himself purged our sins. Now, that sounds settled, doesn't it? Purged, past tense. But sat down is in regard to his ongoing, if you will, the eternal plan. So once he sat down, if you'll picture this, if you'll picture him sitting down, he sat down because it was finished. And you remember that in the tabernacle, there was no chairs in the tabernacle. Well, I'm sorry, there was one. It was called the mercy seat, and you better not sit in it. You can come to it boldly, but don't be sitting in it. Actually, you are seated in it with Christ, okay? But you're not the one who gets there. He brings you there. And that realization has to sink in on a level that will change our identity from Christian that saved to Son in Christ. Okay. So sitting down, the priest never sat down because the work was never done. It was never a finished work. So they were always working. But Jesus is the only one, the high priest, our high priest, that went in and he sat down, but he brought us in there too. Okay, so there is that finished work of salvation, but then there's the ongoing work, and it's still ongoing because we're not all conformed to the image of the Son. Okay. You know, some people say, well, we're not all saved yet either, but, you know, to me, you know, we're saved in Christ. We're not saved by our works. So we are saved, you know. And I know that there are scriptures that deal with that we're saved, we're being saved, and we shall be saved. All of that relates to different parts, spirit, soul, and body, and that's a whole other part. But that's not there to question your salvation. That's there for you to grow up in Him in all things. All right, so there is this work. When he sat down with us in Him, and then we'll get into scriptures like in Ephesians or whatever, where it starts talking about the ongoing thing that he's trying to bring about, literally from church to ultimately to oneness in Son. So let's read on. Being made so much better than the angels, as he hath by inheritance obtained a more excellent name than they. Okay, what name is that? What is it? Son. Yeah, it's a better name than an angel. Angel is a messenger. Angel is a worker. Angel is a servant in that sense. As verse 5, for under which of the angels said he at any time, thou art my son? Okay, now, you know, some people don't mark up their Bibles, but it is, that would be, if there was going to be a thing that you did, if you went through the book of Hebrews, and every time it said son, you just circled it, or you colored it in yellow, or you did something like that. If you did that, you would be shocked. That, in fact, you would conclude that the book of Hebrews is pretty much about this eternal plan in relationship to the Father. All right, but we shall continue here. Son, this day have I begotten thee, and again I will be to him a father, and he shall be to me a son. Okay, now what is the significance of that? I would assume that most of you assume that God, before the foundation of the world, was Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. How many of you would basically agree with that? I know that there are, you know, I have thoughts, but that's, I've never heard anybody else say them, so I don't repeat them. But nonetheless, that God was Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Okay, if that's true, then he was already Son and Father. Now, I mean, listen to the wordings again. Son, this day have I begotten thee, and again I will be to him a father, and he shall be to me a son. What is that talking about? Think about it. Well, it's talking about that there was a death. There was an actual, real death. That the cross killed the Son, as the Father knew it, that the cross crucified, put to death, and in that sense, get ready, never to be seen again, a death of a son to a father. Okay, you say, well, he was raised from the dead, and you know, so how can you say such craziness? First of all, I'm eccentric. I can say this stuff, and, you know. So, but second of all, it was the only begotten Son who died. And when you begin to search the scriptures, you know, especially in the Gospels, Jesus is called the only begotten Son. The only son. Because why? Because at that point he was the only son. There were no sons in the image of Christ. There, we were no longer in that, in the family of God. We were separate from that. And so Jesus, as the only begotten son, died. And when he rose what? A different son. You say, again, this is madness. He rose as a new man. He rose as a son that was no longer the same, but he had a many-membered body, which was us. Okay? And if the Father deals now with the Son, he deals with us in Son. Make sense? I mean, first of all, it'd be one of the only explanations you can come up with. If it says, the Son, this day have I begotten, then you're going, well, what day was that? I thought that was an eternal relationship, Father and Son, always and forever. Can anybody say amen to that? You know? That where is this begetting taking place? Well, it's taking place at the death and the resurrection, where he rose again as a different son than what he was before. All right. You say, well, that sounds like a lot of theology and stuff. Let me tell you something. If you ever get hold of that, you will recognize that God deals with you. If he's dealing with Christ, he's dealing with you. And if he's dealing with you, he's dealing with you as he sees you in Son, in the Son. He's not dealing with you as you. And you need to forsake you. Deny yourself. Take up the, you know what I mean? So we go, okay, I'll deny myself. We go pick up a big heavy cross, whatever it is. I'll serve you, Lord. I'll be whatever you want. You know, and he's going, you're not being what I want right now. You're being you, separate from his cross, separate from him, separate from his death and his resurrection, and never really seeing the Father's plan for sons, just, and not even seeing Jesus' plan for a wife or for a bride, only seeing his plan for redemption, then that's all you're seeing. You're never getting past anything that was in their heart and their, and what they were seeking out of you, but just continually replaying over and over and over the fact that Jesus died for your sins. Okay, but there comes a time when you need to let Jesus sit down. You need to let him sit down. And quit wrestling with stuff that he's not wrestling with. You know, I said something here a long time ago. I think we were over on Maple Street, and I said, you know, Jesus is not moaning and groaning over our sins the way we think he is. He died for them. He's okay with it. He knows that you're forgiven. He just hopes you wake up with it. And you know, and our view is that I just sinned, and the Lord, oh my God, he just, no, you know, I just sinned, and he sees it, and he's so disappointed. He knows you're a mess. He knows you were going to do it. You know, it didn't sneak up on him. You know, that's, you know, like Adam and Eve sinning. Oh, my God. You can see God going, this is shocking. I couldn't even imagine this happening. Well, we're always moaning and groaning and, you know, and at times, you know, freaking out over Jesus' reaction now that I've failed him so bad and this is a big surprise to him. All he wants you to do is look to the cross and look to his shed blood and get back with him. It's that simple. It's that simple. But he wants more than that. He doesn't want your relationship with him continually over what he calls the past. Okay. And the victory over sins and all that stuff, yeah, the blood has already taken care of it. It's a finished work. But isn't it interesting that Jesus' plan for a wife And the Father's plan for Son will actually also eliminate that, because Christ will be formed in you as one with Him. And as a son, the Son will be formed in you, and that will cut down on sins. Because you no longer live, but Christ lives in you. Okay, so all of the things that Christianity is wrestling with come not by Him fulfilling something for you, but by you fulfilling something for Him on these levels. That you find not what you can get out of Jesus or what you can get out of the Father, but you find His heart and you set about to find it in such a manner that you can conform to that and give the Father back His Son as a son. I was thinking about how we go down to the altar and we pray and I'm going to do better and I'm going to do this and all this kind of stuff. And we get up, and even if we somehow we do better, we have still deprived the Father of His Son in us, because we're just doing better. It's not Christ in you, the hope of glory. But do we think of that? No, we tend to think only in terms of sin and failure. And so we think that if I stopped, I've stopped doing that because I love Jesus, but it's not Jesus in you, it's just your commitment level. It's just your commitment level. And it's not Christ, so the Father never gets His Son. So maybe you got forgiveness. Okay, good. That's good. The extreme of that is, praise God, that's good. Now you're not going to go to hell. That's the extreme of it. Is that all? Is that all that's important to us? Is that all that motivates us? Is that all that makes us Christians? Well, we need to move past just being a saved Christian. We need to recognize the Father has invested, and I'm telling you, you would not believe the scriptures that lay this out over and over and over. The Father invested in us His Son, and Jesus said, I'll go pay for it. I'll go die for it. We'll see plenty of scriptures. We'll say that over and over and over again. And scriptures we've read time and time again, that we have always read Jesus where it was talking about the Father. We never saw. So that's part of, number one, what we're going to get into, and that's also part of what I'm going to have you search out to find these verses, because they're just everywhere. All right, so verse 6, and again, when He bringeth in the first begotten into the world, He saith, and let all the angels of God worship Him. Okay? And of the angels He saith, who maketh His angels spirits and His ministers a flame of fire? But unto the Son He saith, thy throne, O God, is forever and ever. A scepter of righteousness is the scepter of thy kingdom. So, again, it's contrasting the Son. So I'm just going to keep reading and notice the contrast. Thou hast loved righteousness and hated iniquity. Therefore God, even thy God, hath anointed thee with the oil of gladness above thy fellows. And thou, Lord, in the beginning hast laid the foundation of the earth, and the heavens are the works of thy hand. They shall perish, but thou remainest, and they all shall become old as a garment. And as a vesture shalt thou fold them up, and they shall be changed. But thou art the same, and thy years shall not fail. Okay, so you're looking at the Son, and imagine the Father talking to His Son. But oh God, the example He gives there is that Jesus is born in a manger, and the angels came in worship. And He says, the first begotten. It is actually the firstborn. And He comes into the world as the only seed of God. The only seed of God. And so All the angels come and they worship him as that. But then he gives himself, and the Father says, "Thy throne, O God, is forever and ever," and you know, everything else is going to vanish and grow old like a garment, but you will last forever. That's talking about us. See, we would make our hope, I'm saved and therefore I have eternal life. That's the way Christians think. I'm saved, so I've got eternal life. That has nothing to do with the plan of the Father and the desire of the Father to get sons. We're not going to give him sons. We're going to give him our religious concepts that actually void out the Son. But the Father put us in Son so that the Son could be put in us. And one picture that you see of that in Hebrews is the high priest, and all the priests, all of the offerings that would go up. You know, in all of those offerings, the priest would come in and he would kill a lamb and offer that up. And so year after year, time after time, every priest that existed killed something else instead of dying. They killed. They were killers. They were matadors. Matador means killer. They killed. But Jesus comes along as the high priest, and he's completely different. He comes along, and he's the offerer, and he's going to offer what the Father wants, a sweet savor. And so he offers himself. And the Father says, now this is the only one that has really been received. And every offering before this was only because they looked forward to this offering. Okay. All right. So the book of Hebrews, when you go through, it's not a contrast of Judaism and Christianity. It's a contrast of Christ with everything else. And when you see that, then you see, and when I say Christ, Christ the Son. So when you see that in Hebrews, you see that as this is a book of the Father. This is his heart. This book will communicate something more than Jesus fulfilled a bunch of stuff. This will fulfill his heart. And then the thing that you see is God had the book of Hebrews written. God the Father had it written. And he wanted, you know, according to his heart, he wants his Son to be seen above everything else. All right. I for whatever reason, I feel like the Holy Spirit keeps circling me back to this thing of plan of salvation. Most of you know better, but I, for whatever reason, I just feel the Holy Spirit just keeps coming back to that and contrasting that with what it should be. That we see all of these things and we religionize them, and then and here's the deal. See, I'm not saying this, of course I feel like I'm getting it from the Holy Spirit, but I'm not saying this because of criticism against what people are doing wrong. I'm saying this because of the Father's heart. What he's not getting over and over and over, when it should be a relationship in Son with the Son, offering as we, you know, because we're New Testament priests, offering this Son to the Father continually, and it being a sweet savor to the Father. Instead, we've got our mind, we've got our, you know, ministries, we've got our ideas, and it's all based on the earth. It's all based on what you can touch, and it's all based on a time period which God would call a little, compared to the Ancient of Days, a little bitty time period, and we're working at that, and we're trying to get it fixed and, you know, shove it up to God and, you know, and may this please you. But we're we're robbing the Father of the very thing that he wanted, that he desired. And we don't see that heart. So to re-say that, I'm not critical of what people are doing wrong. I just see the desire of his heart that he wants more of Christ out of us, more of the Son out of us. And he wants that in a relationship as a son toward a father. Yeah. Not as, I messed up, or I'm this and that, or I've got, I'm going to do this, or I've dedicated my heart to this, or whatever. All the things that really, they're fine. That's why I'm saying I'm not criticizing. They're fine, but they're not this. They miss his heart, just like many people miss the heart of Jesus, the Lamb, in the Christianity that they're allowing to be formed in them instead of his nature, instead of his spirit and his self-giving spirit. All right, so let's go to Colossians chapter 1. I just feel that life down here could be, I mean, what is it? One life to live will soon be lost. Only what's done for Christ will last. Something like that. The truth is, we only get one shot at this. And the eternal relationship with the Father and with his Son, that's going to last forever. And I know this is going to sound dumb, but I don't want to get up there and go, oh, really? This is what it was all about? You know what I mean? Well, I thought it was, world evangelization, or something, taking care of kids. all of that's fine. There's nothing wrong with that. But it's not eternal. But here's the secret. You can bring eternity into it by his spirit and by his nature. Or you can just do it as a dedicated Christian. And there's nothing eternal about it then. You've added nothing of eternity into it, which is him. You've just done. Colossians 1, verse 13. Well, let's go to 12. Giving thanks unto the Father, who hath made us fit to be partakers of the inheritance of the saints in light, who hath delivered us from the power of darkness. Okay, so here's one of the verses that if you'll just look at carefully, we always think that Jesus has delivered us from the power of darkness. This was the Father. It specifically says it in the verse before. Do y'all see that? And the what is the thing of note? If theologically in our mind, we're just reading Jesus the Savior into that instead of the Father and what was in his heart from eternity to bring us in Son, because that's where we're going to end up before this verse is over. Isn't that interesting? Then we're robbing him again and again and again. And if we had the time, it would be interesting to go through the New Testament epistles and point out every time it was relating to the Father and try to see every time that we place that as Jesus the Savior, the one who sat down, and see how many times we walk away from a relationship with the Father by the Son and what the Father wanted. Giving thanks unto the Father who hath made us fit to be partakers of the inheritance of the saints in light, who hath delivered us from the power of darkness and hath translated us into the kingdom of his dear Son. Okay, so the Father did this. He delivered us, past tense, plan of salvation, sat down. Do you hear the finality of that? He hath, past tense, delivered us from the power of darkness and hath translated us into the kingdom of his dear son. Does that sound more ongoing? Okay. So what if we never get past this plan of salvation? What if we're always just either being saved, trying to get people saved, trying to, moving in that vein, and we never realize that there has been a deliverance. He hath delivered us. You say, well, it doesn't seem like it to me. Well, that's because you're not dwelling in the kingdom of his son. And it could have said the kingdom of God, couldn't it? Or the kingdom of heaven. And that's who Matthew was really big on, what kingdom of heaven, wasn't it? Because he walked with Jesus, but he didn't see the fullness of where this Jesus was going to end up, that he was the Son of God, and here was the plan of the Father. And so Paul comes along, and he goes, look, he didn't just deliver us from the power of darkness. He has translated us, and that's past tense, that's settled. He has translated us into the kingdom of the Son of his love. The Son of his love. So this is a big deal to him. You know, he could have sent an angel down here and crucified him, right? Or he could have just deemed Jesus Savior and that's all he came to do. He hath delivered us, period. But he translated us in the kingdom of his son, his dear son, the son of his love. All right. So he's trying to bring something about. He's trying to change our view of our walk. He's trying to change our ways of thinking from just the old patterns of religion and regardless of how true our concepts are of that, with him, he did a finished work in his mind. Jesus sat down and he's going, now you're seated in him and everything flows from the throne, okay? So where do we get sort of a picture from that? Well, we'll go to the book of Revelation again and you have the transparent walls of New Jerusalem, the wife, the bride, and you have him enthroned in her, but him who? Well, it's the Son, but it's the Lamb nature that we're getting to see there, see? Because that has to do with the wife. But it's the same principle. This is, we're in the Son, and everything flows out from him. And we've been seated there in him. All right, so, verse 14, in whom we have redemption, not by whom, but that redemption is because we're in Son. Okay, so is it not true then if Jesus is sitting on the throne and you're in him and his redemption, your redemption took place in him, that your redemption is as settled as Jesus on that throne? Do you think at any time the devil's going to make his way back in there and dethrone Jesus? No, that's not going to happen. But that's not just meant to be assurance of salvation. That's meant to be how you comprehend your relationship with the Father and by the Son, always with the Father and by the Son. And you, well, in whom we have redemption through his blood, even the forgiveness of sins, who is the image of the invisible God. Where did we read that at? Hebrews. Hebrews. We just read it. Hebrews. He is the express image of his person. All right. So Yes, we go back to Genesis 1:26. We go back before there was a devil on the scene. We go back to before sin. We go back to the heart of God, and we find that the Father is orchestrating this thing with the Son and with the Holy Spirit, and he says, I want a certain image, but that image is going to be my Son. And I've placed you, I've translated you in Son because I want this image, because he is the image that I want. Hebrews and here. And it's just kind of a repeat. For by him were all things created. By who? By the Son. By him were all things created that are in heaven and that are in earth, visible and invisible, whether they be thrones or dominion or principalities or power. All things were created by him and for him. And he is before all things, and by him all things consist, and he is the head of the body, the church, who is the beginning, the firstborn from the dead, that in all things he might have the preeminence. For it pleased the Father that in him should all fullness dwell. All right, so this has been an expression of the dedication of the Father's heart that he get sons in the image of Christ. Delivered from darkness just to salvation? No, but in the Son that he loves. So can you see it? Can you see, we go, oh, thank you, Jesus, for the salvation. Thank you. And we're given, and that's fine. I mean, again, there's nothing wrong with that, except if that's all we have, then he's sitting there. The Father's going, I would like more. I would like him. I have expressed in my word that this is the desire of my heart. Well, let's go to Mark chapter 9. So there's an image that only the Son is the express image of, that the Father wants. That we are not that. We are not that. And in that image, if you don't get anything else out of tonight, in that image, you will find what the Father loves about the Son. You will find why he's his dear Son. You will find the very thing, what he loves about the Son. Mark chapter 9, and starting with verse 2. And after 6 days, Jesus taketh with him Peter and James and John, and leadeth them up into a high mountain apart by themselves. And he was transfigured before them, and his raiment became shining, exceedingly white like snow, as no fuller on earth can whiten. So this is a brightness. This is a brightness that Peter will refute later on as the brightness. He'll do it because later on, after this event, years later, when he wrote his epistles, he saw what it was about. He saw the brightness, and he stood for it after that time. White like snow, as no fuller on earth can whiten. And there appeared unto them Elijah and Moses, and they were talking with Jesus. And you remember in Luke, what does it say they were talking about? They were talking about the cross. They were talking about Jesus dying on the cross. They were talking with Jesus about the cross. And what we're going to see is that that's still so much further down than what God wants. And Peter answered and said to Jesus, "Master, it is good for us to be here. Let us make three booths, one for thee and one for Moses and one for Elijah." For he knew not what to say, for they were very much afraid. All right, so everything that has happened up to this point has not had the touch of the Father. It has not had the presence of the Father. It has not had the viewpoint of the Father. It's been miraculous. It's been awe-inspiring. I would say there's been nothing bad that came out of it except Peter shooting off his mouth, But it's just been an incredible thing, and yet it is without a heavenly viewpoint that can only come from the Father, because the Father's relationship with the Son is not based on Jesus' death saved the Father. Do you understand what I'm trying to say? I'm trying to say it's not a salvation relationship. It's not that at all. This is a heavenly relationship, and it's based on realities that do not require earth in that sense. All right. So, verse 7, there was a cloud that overshadowed them, and a voice came out of the cloud saying, "This is my beloved Son. Hear him." And suddenly when they had looked around about, they saw no man anymore except Jesus only with themselves. All right, so what you have here is a mentality that says, we're going to go up, up, up. We're going to ascend. We're going to go up, and we're going to reach heights because that's what we want to do. And not only that, but we're going to be special, the ones that get to go, Peter, James, and John. We're going to be called out from the 12, and we're going to get to see and hear special stuff. Okay? So Jesus, it starts off with Jesus, and he is shining incredibly. And yet, no one seems to be affected by that. Am I right or wrong? I mean, you got Peter, James, John going, "Well, maybe we should make booths." I mean, okay, you got Jesus shining like crazy, but you got Moses and Elijah alive and here, and, you know, and you're going, you know, you're not drawn to the shining brightness, because that shining brightness, as I said, Peter will deal with in true order, doesn't affect anybody, doesn't change anybody. Peter, James, and John are still trying to figure out what to do, and they're thinking in earthly realms, and let's build this and let's do that. And I'm sure they're thinking, this is really something. This is so incredible that Jesus is here and he's shining, and Moses is here and Elijah is here. And then top that off, they're talking about the cross. This is from the beginning almost to Jesus, and they're talking about the cross, and yet the Father is concerned because they're not seeing rightly. Okay. Well, I don't have time to turn here because our time's almost up, so I'll just say this. If you look in, I think it's in 1 Peter, middle way up or something like that, he talks about this majesty, this wonder, this glory, and we saw it and we were there. He's talking about the Mount of Transfiguration. And he says, oh, you know, and it was the heights. Listen to his words. It was the heights, and it was glory, and it was majesty, and it's everything. But he says, then he says, but you know what, guys? We have a more sure word of prophecy to which you should take heed. And the light he starts talking about in Jesus standing there shining, it's from the word, and it is the light. It is the, how's he word it? Until you need to stay with this until that light, the day dawn and the day star shines in your heart. That's refuting the other. It's not saying it's wrong, though. When I say refuting, I'm just using a word to try to. He's not saying that's wrong, because he said it was great majesty, but he said, you know, I'm telling you, there's something greater that needs to happen in us, and that's a greater light that will affect us and that will change us. Okay, so let's try to finish this off here. So the Father, in verse 7, there was a cloud that overshadowed them, and a voice came out of the cloud saying that this is my beloved Son, hear him. What makes this different from when Jesus was baptized? This is my beloved Son in whom I'm well pleased. He adds, hear him, right? Okay, well, if I forget it, let me go back to the baptism in just a minute. All right, so you got verse 8. And suddenly when they looked about round about, they saw no man anymore except Jesus only with themselves. And as they came down from the mountain, he charged them that they should tell no man what things they had seen till the Son of Man were risen from the dead. Okay? He said, hear him. And this is the first thing he spoke. Don't tell anybody about the great, glorious thing. It's not about that. Don't, you know, because this whole event is not this, and he's about to show you what this really is about and why the Father loves. This is my beloved Son. Hear him. Don't, first of all, I'm not trying to become something based on this, and he's not. This isn't what it's all about. You guys think, coming up here and all of this is the best, and those poor guys down there that didn't get to see all of this, they missed out and all this kind of stuff. But Jesus is saying, this is not what it's about. Don't tell anybody about this until after I'm raised from the dead, because then they'll see what died and what God exalted, the true nature. Come on, think about it. Then they'll see, then they'll understand. But here, all you're going to do is just puff people up and make them think that there's something, because they've climbed the heights. So Jesus is going to do what now? After he speaks, he's going to take them down. Okay? Verse 14, and when he was come to his disciples, he saw a great multitude about them, and the scribes questioning with them. So Jesus comes down, and there's this mess going on. This is just one part of it. What's going on? The Pharisees have got hold of the disciples without Peter, James, and John, and they're going, well, they're questioning them, and they don't know how to answer, and it's like they've got them on the ropes and all kind of stuff. That's the first thing. And straightway all the people, when they beheld him, were greatly amazed, running to him and greeting him. So you got this multitude, and they're all right in the midst of this, running over, oh, Jesus, Jesus, oh, it's good to have you here. It's good to, you know, do you know who you have here? It's good to have you here, because you can heal, or you can feed, or you can do. And so now you've got this rush of people, not done yet. And he, verse 16, and he asked the scribes, what question you with them? And one of the multitude answered and said, Master, I have brought unto thee my son, who is hath a dumb spirit. Those dumb spirits. Anyway, and wherever he taketh him, he teareth him, and he foameth and gnasheth with his teeth and pineth away. And I spoke to thy disciples that they should cast him out, and they could not. And he answered unto them and saith, O faithless generation, how long shall I be with you? How shall I endure thee? Bring him to me. And he brought them to him. And when he saw him, straightway the spirit convulsed him. And he fell on the ground and wallowed foaming. And he asked his father, how long ago was it since this came upon him? And he said, from a child. And often it hath cast him into the fire and into the waters to destroy him. But if thou canst do anything, have compassion on us and help us. And Jesus said unto him, if thou canst believe, all things are possible to him that believeth. And straightway the father of the child cried out and said with tears, Lord, I believe, help thou my unbelief. When Jesus saw that the people came running together, he rebuked the foul spirit, saying unto him, thou dumb and deaf spirit, I charge thee, come out of him and enter no more into him. And the spirit cried and convulsed him greatly, and he came out of him, and he was like one dead. This doesn't look like a victory. He was like one dead, inasmuch that many said, he is dead. But Jesus took him by the hand, lifted him up, and he arose. Okay, so you've got Jesus on the mount. You've got him glowing. You've got Moses and Elijah. You've got the top three disciples. You've got the best of the best in this situation, way up on the mountaintop where we all want to go and live. And the Father comes up and he overshadows it and he says, this is my beloved Son. Hear him. And then now things are going to start happening with purpose and eternal reality behind it. It all ends. They only see Jesus, and he speaks, and he says, don't tell anybody this until death and resurrection are involved in this. Yes. And then he leaves. He goes down, and it's like up here. I don't know if you've ever been on a mountain where the clouds were below you, but it's a gorgeous sight. So he goes down, and down here is just a soup of darkness, and the Pharisees are arguing with the disciples, and they're scared because they don't know how to answer them, and all the people are running, going, oh, Jesus, and all this kind of stuff, you got this father with his son that's messed up and everything, and so you've got this swirl. It's almost like a soup going on down there. That's the Jesus the Father loves, the one who will leave heaven, that will leave everything above, will leave the best spot, will leave the heights, will leave the glory, will leave that and come down. And the Father looks at him and he says, you don't even see him. And so he blotted out everything and he says, now hear him, and of course you'll see him. And what comes out of his mouth is, don't talk about that. Don't lift me up. Don't point to this. Don't go there. And then he says, follow me. We're going down, not up. And in closing on this, you remember the book of Revelation. The only time it mentions the bride, the wife, it always mentions she's coming down from God out of heaven. I'll tell you why the Father loves the Son. Because he's so selfless. Because he's not trying to gain glory or heights or whatever. He's had all of that, but that doesn't display his true spirit. And it doesn't express the image of the Father. So the Father says, let him alone. Let him be what he is. And when all of the hubbub and all of the brightness and all of the people of stature and, you know, glory are gone, he just says, don't lift me up. Don't talk about this. Don't use this as a premise by which you build my ministry. And then he says, let's go down. It's going to be really ugly, but that's my spirit. Let's finish. Father, just bless the word and bless our hearts to comprehend your heart, Father. Jesus' name. Amen.